What makes a video game more enjoyable? Actual gameplay. I'm real tired of things being fetch this, talk to this guy and spam X to win, or worse, auto battlers which are AFK to win. I wanna actually have to either think about what I'm doing or have to press more than one button. Games without gameplay are just chores. This is what got me to play all the way through Breath of the Wild, where no other open world game has ever held my attention before. More specifically, and perhaps more embarrassingly, the game didn't punish me for avoiding combat or finding creative solutions around a horde of enemies. My assault on Hyrule Castle was more akin to a break-in than an all-out attack. And hell, even the music reflected on my decision. Rather than the game forcing me into a generic combat dungeon for the final build-up, yet at the same time, the game has more complex combat options and plenty of tough enemies for the more combat-inclined players to go find and beat. It's the perfect mix. Immersion. Getting really immersed into the world of the video game. One way this is accomplished is making a lot of things interactive in the game, and learning the game world's lore or history. I don't mean sitting through a 15-minute lecture over the history of the game world, looks pointedly at Quirin, undying thoughts, but finding books, notes, plaques, signs, tapes, or other forms of information that give little glimpses into the history and overall dynamic of the world you're in makes it seem more real, and makes you feel more connected to the world. In contrast, I really liked Ghost of Tsushima difficulty setting. Enemies become just a little more aggressive, but instead of better stats and HP, everything just dies quicker, including the enemies. This way, the difficulty setting directly scales the risk, reward ratio and rewards good play with more cinematic fights, but also does as its difficulty level would suggest and punishes players more for their mistakes. More games need to take after GOT. Warframe has absolutely fucking spoiled me in this regard. Once you get used to bullet jumping and the Parker mechanics, it's really, really hard to go back. Also how fast everything is, too, you never feel too slow. On another thing, Breath of the Wild's climbing mechanics. I really loved how the only thing that limits what you can climb is for the most part either weather or your stamina gauge. Other than that, you can climb almost anything in the overworld. The Metroid franchise is amazing in the music department. The music really adds to the eerie and lonely atmosphere of exploring dangerous alien environments. This example from Metroid Ness really shows an alien-esque sound design representing uncertainty in space. https://www.youtube.com/watch.v=k5l9twdrbxk. I can't speak to the depression advice, but I can speak to the backlog, which I've seen a number of people struggle with. Video games are most likely not your profession, but rather a pastime, and having fun should be your top priority. That is to say, don't force yourself to play games you don't like. Don't force yourself to engage in activities that you don't enjoy, and ignore people who tell you otherwise. Stop thinking of your backlog as a to-do list and start thinking of it as a suggestion box where you may go when you're stumped for something to play. Don't play if you don't feel like it. It's also quite acceptable to skip your backlog in favor of a soothing round of your favorite multip. Good movement. I feel like it gets so underlooked by some devs, but making the act of moving enjoyable can do wonders for the playability of a game. I'm not even talking about fancy Parker stuff necessarily, although these can be cool. Just tight responsive controls with the ability to do some more advanced stuff with skill does wonders for a game. It's why games like Hollow Knight feel so good to play. When I was younger, I thought the notion of DLC was super cool. I grew up on PC gaming, late 90s/early to mid-00s, and really liked buying a game, and then being able to extend the lifespan of said game with mods and other stuff, and hated console gaming because I'd spend like $30 plus on one game and once I was done with it, that's really it. So when consoles started getting more onboard storage, X360/PS3, and support for DLC, I was excited. This meant that hey, I could probably extend the life of games I already purchased without having to plunk down another huge chunk of money, and maybe developers could push updates with additional content, too. But, of course, this was mostly used just to pave the way for shitty microtransactions, paid DLC of questionable worth, and as an excuse to ship a shitty, incomplete game with promises to make it better later whilst grabbing all that pre-order, early sale lucre, mate. As somebody who enjoys RPGs, I really need character motivation in the character development. My pet peeve is when a character is shy but then randomly becomes brave, or somebody who is really aggressive and selfish but then does something very kind for everybody, without any reason, just a random massive change in personality, that breaks the immersion for me. I like to know why a character acts the way they do, why they have the personality they do, and to stay consistent with it. A simple backstory can help. Big RPG fan also, and I think you'll agree that even though it is terrible when they do those random personality changes and just pretend it is character development, showing actual character development for those same things makes them amazing. If someone is selfish, show me them being selfish, but then show me why they are selfish, and if their personality is going to change, hint at it at first. Make it a process. It can still be a big moment when they do their unselfish act, but it should be because they have invested in that moment and not just herp derp random personality change. After playing Cyberpunk, I never realized how much I took audio cues for granted. The little ping that signals you've completed an objective, the sounds of an enemy getting louder as you close in, combat music stopping and starting, because the audio was so janky in Cyberpunk. She spent so much of the game extremely frustrated, trying to find enemies that weren't there but still had audio playing, wandering around because I wasn't sure if I'd finished an objective. Games that nudge you in the right direction without even making you think are like working toilets. You don't even think about it until it's gone. Horizon Zero Dawn without good sound would be impossible on the harder difficulties. I was using the sounds of the two machines fighting behind me while I shot another one to tell what they were doing. I've played this game so much I now know what almost any machine is doing by its sounds. If I had a surround sound system, I could probably play it blind. Sound is way more important than graphics. This is why, as a hardcore gamer between the 90s up to about 2013, I thought it was a much more enjoyable time as a gamer. One full price for the whole game, then additional content was free to download through mods, etc. Sometimes expansion came out, but they were worth it and not integral to the experience of the original game, such as BF2, Special Forces. Holy shit, did I spend a fuckton of Friday and Saturday nights in that game with friends, haha. I sound dated now saying this, of course, but now gaming seems all about how much you can eventually wring from people's wallets with a lower initial price to start. I find that disingenuous and annoying. It's why I thoroughly enjoy classic gaming these days. Low time commitment, extremely low cost, great hours spent with friends. I've played a lot of games and am a programmer, but not a game programmer. I enjoy it when I don't understand how a game works, like it does something so well or unexpected that I can't even imagine how the algorithms work. GTA V would be one example. There is so much going on and it doesn't feel artificial or like a game. All at once you've got lots of vehicles driving down the streets, planes overhead, people walking, talking, dropping things, police chasing people, dogs running around, trains running. How they do all that with the game still performing decently is beyond me. Satisfying feedback. It's one of those things that you hardly even notice unless it's absent, but the feedback a game provides when an action is performed is incredibly important to how enjoyable a game is to play. If I collect something, there should be some sound or indication that that item has been added to my inventory or collection. If I hit something I'm supposed to hit, I expect there to be a corresponding sound, visual indicator, controller vibration or combination of those things to let me know to keep doing that thing. Specifically good character customization. Too many games have had either lacking or super finicky modes of customization and fucked it up. Also neutral, unshadowed lighting in the CC. Can't tell you how often my characters gonked because the lighting in the CC screen made them look fine. Example, I was playing Dragon's Dogma, and I thought I had my character looking alright in the CC lighting. Then in game, for some fucking unknowable reason, my guy had a concave face and a button-looking nose. I came here to say this, I don't even play games anymore. Max Payne 3 was the most recent title I've played, but I noticed this becoming a trend. The other day, I saw a video of Ghost of Tsushima where there is a happy fox dancing around you and you can pet it, and this made me so happy, and I know that I would enjoy playing this game for this very reason. Immersion. Be it music, well-written dialogue and characters, lively towns and environments, I want to feel like it's a worthy escape, as, to me, that's what video games are for. Even better when gameplay mechanics are meshed with the story, narrative, like in Vagrant Story on the PS1 when Ashley recovers repressed memories he gets new abilities to use in combat. It's all about immersion. I appreciate when games aren't holding my hand and just drop you into an empty area to figure shit out on your own. If you hit me with a ton of menus and tutorials, I'm infinitely less interested in playing. I can figure most of this out on my own. See, The Witness. They don't explain shit. You're alone in an empty area with nobody to talk to and a bunch of doors with basic puzzles on them. The farther you go and more complex the puzzles get, you begin to understand the mechanics simply by playing the game. You start noticing how doors and other devices are affected by the puzzles. Breath of the Wild did this pretty good too, with trapping you on an island and you have to solve the 3 shrines before you're allowed to leave. They didn't hold your hand and tell you how to get through the ice area. You figure it out by exploring and learning the recipe for a hot drink. Wizardry 7, an old game, drops you off in the middle of nowhere and doesn't give you any guidance. If you head north, you die or fall asleep in a field of flowers. You head south, you die to forest monsters. You head to the nearby city and the guard won't let you inside. Then through exploration you find your first dungeon, and at the end you get a password that will get you into the city. Love it. When you play a game and take into consideration all of the different minds that came together to make everything work as it does, all motivated through their creative passion to bring their vision to life for the rest of the world to explore and have their own unique experiences in, playing any game like the work of art that it is always much more rewarding and enjoyable than playing a game assuming that it was made to trick you into giving money to the greedy companies that create them. Most games were created from the passion of other gamers that worked hard to eventually become devs. And the few games out there that are actual cash grabs are pretty obvious when you play them. A meaningful balance of risk versus reward. I'm not saying every game needs to be Dark Souls, but I have trouble getting into a game when the stakes are almost non-existent. I was playing Dead Island for the first time, because I'm very up to date on the latest games. The game's age aside, it was an absolute blast impaling zombies with various kitchen implements. Then, I died. And after a 10-second respawn timer, my character got back up with full health in the same place they fell, with all the enemies they'd killed still gone. Even the boss monster, who had gotten to half health, kept that damage registered. I let the enemies kill me again, just to see if this was some sort of limited grace period, but no, I died. Waited 10 seconds, and got back up like nothing had even happened. I stopped playing shortly thereafter. Suddenly the last few hours seemed pointless. I hasn't been locked in a deadly battle for survival, barely scrapping by thanks to a thrilling combination of wits, skill, and bald-faced luck. In reality, I'd been slowly slogging through a backlog of virtual tasks at which I couldn't possibly fail. Literally, the only thing actually being demanded of me was time. Look, generally speaking, all video games are a waste of time, but nothing makes me more agonizingly aware that a game is a big old time as ink than discovering there are zero consequences for failure. knowing where to go. Back in the day, you were literally given directions. Sometimes go east 50 steps, then look for the gray rock next to a tree. Get out with that. I wanna know exactly where I need to go at all times. It helps keep the momentum of the game going and makes the action feel non-stop. After playing Master Chief Collection recently, too many times was I left wondering where to go, totally killing the experience. Check out 4 Keys to Fun by Nicole Lotsoro. In a nutshell, it was research into why people play games, and it defines basically 4 types of fun that players are drawn to. People fun, friendship, amusement from competition and cooperation, easy fun, novelty, curiosity from exploration, role play, and creativity, hard fun, challenge, hero, the epic win, from achieving a difficult goal, serious fun, meaning, excitement from changing the player and their world. Ability to save at any point so you can drop the game to attend to real life things without losing progress. Time is precious. Ability to skip cutscenes and dialogue. Ability to change the difficulty mid-game so if you're finding a game frustrating you can still complete it. Likewise, if it's too easy you can ramp up the difficulty without having to start from scratch again. If a game relies on PvP, it still has an option for bots so that when the player base thins out or and moves on, you don't have totally dead game. The game can be modded, thus the player base can make improvements and keep the game alive long after the devs have moved on. Not worrying about what other people think of that game. Too many people care about what others think of a game. I play many unpopular games too, and sometimes the least popular game in a series ends up being my favorite. For example, Call of Duty Ghosts as well as Black Ops Cold War are my 2 favorite Call of Duty games. I've also played every Call of Duty since Finest Hour religiously, and tend to put lots of time into them. I see Fallout 76 as being equal to Fallout New Vegas, and Fallout 4. Those 3 are the best Fallout games. I've also played Fallouts 1, 2, and 3 as well, but they aren't much compared to New Vegas, 4, and 76, though they are still good. I find the Star Wars Battlefront 2 from 2017 to be better than the Star Wars Battlefront 2 from 2005. I even grew up playing the Star Wars Battlefront 2 from 2005, but the 2017 one is still better to me. People need to learn to only care about their personal tastes when it comes to video games, and they shouldn't care what other people think. Also, people shouldn't take video games so seriously either. I could care less that my choices of favorite games aren't popular, as I know how to develop my own opinion instead of following the bandwagon or listening to what others say about a game. I don't even look at video game reviews either, with the exception of looking at technical aspects of video games from reviewers, as a game has to at least run good, and there isn't any room for personal opinion when it comes to tech specs, so reviews count. Matter there, but not anywhere else. For me, a game with no online multiplayer. Every great game has been ruined when they decide to half-ass the single-player story mode. Fallout is a great example of ruining a game for the sake of adding multiplayer, also adding insanely difficult quests. The challenge can be fun, but I'm really there for the story. Or on the opposite side, adding mind-numbingly boring and repetitive quests that have to be completely to progress. Fishing is a great example of this. I use subtitles and watch movies on my laptop while I game on my TV. I always hated having to choose between catching up on shows, movies, or choosing between video games, so I just combined them. Some people think it's crazy because they need to use their expensive headphones to game better, but I do just fine without it. Sometimes I will pause my show, movie if there's a big cutscene in the game though. It's what I can do between the scripted and expected quest the devs gave me in the environment. For example, games that lets you screw around with the physics like Deus Ex and HL 2, Hidden Gems. I behavior that involves creating further stories with consequences like Mass Effect, and all other aspects where I can have fun pushing the game without having to follow any quest. Conversely, chores, as long as the chores are fun. I don't mind a walking simulator as long as I have some scenery to help me enjoy the walk. Great example is Breath of the Wild, Just exploring feels fun even though it's a bit chore.